Voy para allá.
Ah, vas a atender.
Si te pido un favor, agárrame una cosa.
Ah, que te agarren. Sí.
El constitucionalismo social bolivariano. Somos gente de leyes, aferrados a esta constitución hermosa que trató también de ser evitada, impedida y luego asesinada en estos años que hemos vivido. A nosotros nos mueve una idea muy profunda de patria, de dignidad, de honor venezolanista. A nosotros nos mueve sentimientos muy intensos de amor por lo nuestro, de amor por la historia gloriosa que se ha levantado de este lugar de Sudamérica llamado Venezuela.
Democrático de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. Una vez más queda demostrado que la soberanía reside intransferiblemente en usted, conforme a lo previsto en el artículo 5 de la Constitución de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. El día de ayer, domingo 28 de julio del 2024, expresaron su voluntad absoluta, eligiendo como presidente constitucional de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela al ciudadano Nicolás Maduro Mora. Para el periodo 2025-2031, conforme lo previsto en el artículo 130 de la Constitución de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. Para un periodo de 6 años de conformidad con lo establecido en el artículo de la Constitución de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. Se hace entrega del acta de totalización, adjudicación y proclamación del presidente de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. República Bolivariana de Venezuela. Poder electoral. Consejo Nacional Electoral. Credencial. Presidente de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela. El Consejo Nacional Electoral, en uso de las atribuciones que le confiere el artículo 33.6 de la Ley Orgánica del Poder Electoral, artículo 153 de la Ley Orgánica de Procesos Electorales, artículo 39, 391 y 393 del Reglamento General de la Ley Orgánica de Procesos Electorales, acredita al ciudadano Nicolás Maduro Moro, titular de la cédula de identidad B58924, postulado por la organizaciones con fines políticos, Partido Socialista Unido de Venezuela. Como presidente electo de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela en la elección presidencial celebrada el 28 de julio del 2024 para un periodo de 6 años, de conformidad con lo establecido en los artículos 228-230 de la Constitución de la República Bolivariana de Venezuela, en la ciudad de Caracas, a los 29 días del mes de julio del 2024. La misión de llevar la rienda de nuestra patria, la misión de llevar la rienda de una revolución que le pertenece a los humildes, al pueblo. Ellos creyeron que todo había llegado hasta su final. Y otra vez miraron al norte, y el norte les dio la orden. Fuimos a elecciones, ganamos con un margen modesto. Este muchacho que está aquí apenas tenía 10 días, apenas acababa de despedir a su jefe, a su madre, a su maestro. Y con ese dolor inmenso, sus hijos, sus hijas y su pueblo salimos a dar la batalla. Y le ganamos a un consumado apellido de la oligarquía, un chiquito popó, el Caprilín. El Caprile, un tipo lleno de ego, de morbo, tipo lleno de morbo. Quizás es uno de los que más odie, pero el papel que le asignan los gringos a Caprile como agente en Venezuela es simular ser un político. ¿Cuántas máquinas auditaron cuando el presidente Donald Trump denunció el fraude que supuestamente le hicieron? ¿Cuántas? ¿Cuántos comunicados emitieron algunos gobiernos para exigir que se revisaran todas las máquinas cuando el presidente Donald Trump dijo lo que dijo? ¿Cuántas? ¿Cuántos comunicados? ¿Cuántos pronunciamientos? ¿O ustedes creen que Venezuela es colonia? Si es colonia me van avisando porque no me he enterado. De repente ya somos colonia. Somos una estrella, como le querían gritar una estrella a la bandera de Venezuela, esa estrella de repente ahora somos de la bandera de Estados Unidos. Y no nos hemos enterado. En la realidad virtual de repente ya somos colonia y tenemos que obedecer a los gringos y entregar nuestro territorio y nuestra riqueza. Ustedes me van diciendo pues si somos colonia. e impedían la transmisión de los datos para provocar lo que puede llamarse un apagón electoral. No pudieron provocar el apagón eléctrico, un apagón electoral, y no hubiera resultados electorales, y a esta hora no hubiera resultados electorales, y ellos tuvieran encendida Venezuela, creo yo, en su fracasada incursión en la política desde la conspiración. A ustedes también me dirijo. Esta Venezuela les pertenece a ustedes, ustedes viven aquí. No puede ser que por acción de odio, de violencia, por una improvisación, por el ego y el capricho de unos apellidos, pretendan echarle una broma otra vez a la comunidad tal, a la comunidad tal.
El centro electoral en el CNE, del Centro del Poder Electoral de Venezuela. Estoy aquí en una mesa con los camaradas antiperistas claros de Hermelín de Malcot y también Cristian Nader. Y bueno, lo que vamos a hacer es una conversación, tal como la tendríamos nosotros, solo que transmitida en vivo para todos vosotros, un poco transmitir nuestras primeras impresiones de cómo está la situación, ¿no? Tras la alegría de ayer con la celebración de una victoria anunciada de Nicolás Maduro, también el anuncio de algunas alegrías que tienen que moderarse en cuanto a que se vaya a reconocer o conformar esta victoria en todos los sectores del país, porque van a venir influenciados, motivados y juzgados por otros, ¿no? Yo simplemente diría una frase y con esto le paso el testigo a los camaradas, pero digan que hablo yo mucho, que esto solo acaba de comenzar. Es decir, para mí hay un lapso de tiempo desde aquí hasta que consigamos esa unidad también en destino de Venezuela, Cuba y Nicaragua, a través de BRICS y a través de esa relación ya profunda que ya en parte lo está siendo, pero manifiesta y declarada con los países de los BRICS, sobre todo con Rusia, China e Irán, para que esto de verdad llegue a una cierta tranquilidad y a la capacidad transformadora que a pesar de los bloqueos le hacen a estos países, ¿no? Y que tienen, porque sus gobiernos y sus fines y sus motivaciones y su ideología es más pueblo que ninguno de los gobiernos liberales del orden occidental basado en guerras, que no en reglas. Así que, ¿qué opináis? Trae, que me das el móvil y yo te sigo grabando el pendiente.
Bueno, yo quería hablar un poquito del proceso electoral y de cómo ha pasado la victoria de Nicolás Maduro. Tenemos que saber que estas elecciones pasaron en un tiempo de guerra en Venezuela. Eso no se reconoce suficientemente. Una guerra económica, una guerra diplomática y una guerra incluso militar. Una guerra económica con más de 930 sanciones en contra de Venezuela. Hace poco incluso la Unión Europea añadió sanciones a Venezuela. Por eso el CNE no aceptó que la Unión Europea fuese observador del proceso electoral, porque era obvio que no eran neutros. Por 100 dólares que se sacaba de la renta petrolera en 2014, en 2023 solamente se sacaba un dólar y el país tuvo que seguir con el mismo ritmo de vida y aumentar la posibilidad del Estado en este entorno. Esa es la guerra económica que se está haciendo contra Venezuela, con también un montón de sabotajes, etc. Una guerra diplomática reconociendo al payaso de Guaidó como presidente por parte de Estados Unidos, la Unión Europea, muchos países europeos y todos los lacayos de Estados Unidos. Y al final una guerra militar en contra de Venezuela con tentativas de asesinato del presidente Nicolás Maduro e invasión militar, y recientemente en la Guayana de Esequibo también están ahí presentes las fuerzas del imperio tratando de acabar con el proceso bolivariano. Esa es una primera cosa. Y entonces hay que entender que la victoria de Nicolás Maduro, que es una victoria contundente, tiene 7 puntos en tiempo de guerra. La gente estuvo padeciendo condiciones de vida muy duras y se recuperó la economía desde 2 o 3 años por la muy buena gestión del gobierno, y el resultado que estamos viendo hoy día es el resultado de esta muy buena gestión y de la confianza que esto va a seguir, que este proceso puede ir por adelante. adelante porque dan las pruebas que aunque la guerra sigue, el gobierno sabe responder y sabe actuar.
Bueno, Cristian, ¿qué parte de la historia comentar? ¿La parte de proyección hacia el exterior, el ataque al exterior, por ejemplo, o prefieres añadir algo más de lo que estamos comentando?
Creo que es importante lo que mencionaste sobre la protección y el cobijo a Venezuela, porque por supuesto tiene muchos enemigos, pero también tiene muchos amigos. Hay que mencionar que en este proceso llegaron desde 107 países, más de 1,000 observadores electorales de distintas tendencias políticas, unos más cercanos al proceso bolivariano, otros bastante distantes incluso. Y creo que es interesante la opción que tú dijiste, ¿no? Una manera de salvaguardar la integridad y la relación con Venezuela es su cercanía con el bloque de los BRICS, por citar un caso, ¿no? Concretamente Rusia y China, que son los países que mantienen una excelente relación. Bueno, además también la República Islámica de Irán, que mantiene una excelente relación con Venezuela. Sumaría otros, de hecho, otras naciones que no forman parte del bloque. Qatar, por ejemplo, la relación entre Qatar y también con Turquía es muy íntima. Y creo que vincularse a los BRICS, además de acuerdos estratégicos, incluso de corte militar, podrían hacer que el desafío que enfrenta Venezuela ante la oleada por parte de Washington sea mucho más fácil de evitar, obviamente, ¿no? Por supuesto, sabíamos perfectamente, yo en lo particular, que pese al triunfo, ya sea con una holgada diferencia, con una diferencia muy cercana como fue, sabíamos que solo sería el principio del proceso, porque el proceso en sí es injerencia y resistir es injerencia. La primera victoria es la electoral, la segunda victoria es resistir la oleada y la marejada de guerra económica, guerra mediática, principalmente la mediática, incluso guerra, esperemos que no sea así, paramilitar y militar. Como lo dijo Ermelinda, han ocurrido hechos de sabotaje, algunos que incluso algunos, no puedo decir levantamientos, pero pequeños intentos, pequeños brotes, y creo que se han sabido controlar. Y lo que está apostando Washington en este momento es justamente recrudecer, en primer lugar, tratar de provocar un levantamiento, creo que no lo van a hacer, y lamentablemente activar a los grupos paramilitares que se encuentran dentro de Venezuela ya, o en las fronteras, como también lo notó Ermelinda, en suelo brasileiro, en suelo colombiano, e incluso también en la Guyana. Recordemos que Venezuela también vive un proceso para recuperar el control del territorio Esequibo, que ha estado en disputa con Guyana, ex colonia británica, que de facto sigue siendo realmente un territorio británico. Entonces creo que hay demasiadas aristas, pero lo primordial es eso, que Venezuela resista, porque a fin de cuentas conocemos que en Occidente, pese a que se anuncie un triunfo electoral y que se ha observado el proceso y la limpieza de dicho, obviamente es imposible que hacer que recapacitaran los poderes en Occidente, jamás lo van a hacer. El objetivo es volver a controlar el territorio venezolano vía una élite cipaya y por supuesto administrar los grandes recursos de Venezuela, desde los hidrocarburos hasta también el oro, véase también el Esequibo, y una zona geoestratégica en el Caribe fundamental para el control territorial de América Latina.
Sí, yo añadí una ronda más, si quieres, rápida.
Yo también.
Yo creo que el cinismo que ya ha demostrado, el nivel de cinismo, el nivel de absurdo, el nivel en que se ha llegado con las comunicaciones ahora mismo tras el genocidio que estamos sufriendo en Palestina, bueno, el repunte del genocidio que lleva 75 años, pues demuestra que son capaces de cualquier cosa y van a seguir haciendo.
Y más en este momento.
Y más en este momento, y van a seguir haciendo. Por tanto, cuando yo decía lo de moderar, el entusiasmo es moderar, moderar ese entusiasmo pensando en que ellos van a seguir aprovechando toda la arremetida mediática que están haciendo, ¿no? Por supuesto que tenemos también que abundar en las certezas, que es este proceso. Vamos a hacer un programa especial el viernes en el canal. Viernes este que estamos, ya sí, este viernes. Un programa especial en el canal, el que pienso traer también todo el tema del proceso electoral, explicarlo bien para que vean cómo y en qué contundente es realmente la forma en que está garantizado el voto y está garantizada la limpieza de las elecciones. Pero por ahí, por encima, siempre tendremos que pensar que el eje antiimperialista solo se conserva fuerte en los países que también toman unas medidas de transformación ideológica y material para que el pueblo se sienta fuerte también ante esta situación. En este momento tenemos una Cuba sufriendo más que nunca, una Venezuela que en cambio está abriéndose cada vez más en 14 meses de crecimiento constante, lo que le da aire, pero ese aire sabemos que es un aire que ahora mismo quieren volver a asfixiar para que no lo tenga ni Nicaragua, ni Cuba, ni Venezuela, en una América Latina que va a ser el refugio del imperio tras su caída en todo el cerco que le están haciendo en Asia, ¿no? Por supuesto con la desaparición de los sionistas, que la celebraremos tanto más. que cualquier otro evento antiperista del mundo mundial, ¿no?
Y que, mencionar que Corina Machado también era pro-sionista y bastante pujante a favor del sionismo aquí en Venezuela.
Por cierto, a ver, por favor, aquellos que levantan la cara diciendo, oh, con Kamala va a ser diferente, mira cómo te está diciendo, perdón, perdón, lo primero que ha hecho Estados Unidos a día de hoy es precisamente no reconocer el resultado electoral. Bueno, te paso que sé que tenías cosas que contar.
Yo quería añadir que, ¿qué toca hacer hoy como activistas y militantes? Van a haber dos cosas. Primeramente, la derecha, la extrema derecha va a desatar la violencia porque lo necesitan justificar su sueldo. También va a haber una batalla dentro de las derechas para ver quién capta la mayor cantidad de dinero de Estados Unidos. Se van a pelear entre ellos, pero también van a dar la pelea aquí. Entonces tenemos que informar, pero tenemos que guardar la calma. Eso solamente es la María Corina Machado queriendo justificar su sueldo a su dueño de Estados Unidos. Entonces, ¿qué nos toca a nosotros, principalmente como militantes? Yo creo que es defender el proceso en Venezuela. Venezuela ahorita está tratando de transformar su economía y lo ha hecho ya a pasos muy importantes de transformación de la economía para salirse de la renta petrolera. Tenemos que discutir un poquito de la historia de Venezuela porque creo que la historia económica de Venezuela es mal conocida, pero hay que tomar en cuenta que Nicolás Maduro volvió a sacar la economía por adelante, pero no por el petróleo, por el
sector. La economía.
Y pacificó la economía. Entonces, invirtió mucho en la economía agrícola por el momento y eso fue lo que trajo el país por adelante. Y eso dio la confianza a los inversores que Venezuela era fuerza de estabilidad, que el gobierno de Nicolás Maduro era fuerza de estabilidad. Pero lo que vamos a ver es una parte de la izquierda que va a decir, mira que se está volviendo neoliberal, etcétera. No, tenemos que dar la pelea. Un Estado socialista no puede compartir la escasez. Un Estado socialista tiene que desarrollar las fuerzas productivas. Esa es la primera tarea. Entonces, es lo que está haciendo el presidente Nicolás Maduro. Pero al mismo tiempo sabe muy bien cuáles son los sectores estratégicos que no pueden quedarse fuera de las manos del Estado. Entonces, tienes la petroquímica, la minería, la siderurgia. Hay sectores así importantes. Y hay sectores que no son importantes, que eran públicos del Estado y que sí se han privatizado, pero eran como torrefacción de café. ¿Para qué importa que eso sea sector estratégico del Estado? No lo es. O sea que eso es normal que el Estado lo deje a las manos privadas, porque también da una forma de estabilidad al país, porque permite que la tasa de cambio se... O sea, son temas económicos que tenemos que trabajar.
Tenemos el ejemplo ahí con China y con Rusia, que además de ser apoyos, tiene un conocimiento brutal.
Sí.
A ti mismo te ha costado un montón. Con esos países consolidados, China consolidada, que decir a estas izquierdas que te dicen que no son...
Exactamente.
Que son capitalistas, que decirles, por favor, entender el momento histórico.
Entonces yo veo que esa es la tarea que vamos a tener que hacer como militantes, estudiar la economía de Venezuela, ver cómo se desarrolla y entender el proceso y no caer en las trampas de decir que porque se desarrolla económicamente Venezuela se está yendo del malo lado. No, el socialismo no significa escasez y no significa perder el control de la economía. Al contrario, es desarrollo.
Le dejamos rematar algo a Cristian, ¿no? Por eso de que...
A mí me gustaría agregar que más allá, por supuesto, está el ejército bolivariano presto a detener cualquier intento de injerencia, pero también hay que entender que dentro de la sociedad venezolana se vive un proceso de autodefensa ante cualquier eventualidad. El ejército, aunque parezca de manera sorprendente, no es la última línea de defensa del pueblo bolivariano. El mismo pueblo bolivariano, que a través de los años ha sufrido una transformación, no nada más política, sino también militante, posee las herramientas, incluso armadas si es necesario, para resistir un proceso de injerencia dentro de Venezuela o desde el exterior. Y por supuesto, los servicios de inteligencia venezolanos saben perfectamente lo que está gestando en sus fronteras inmediatas, pero también en la lejanía. Y recordar una cosa, esto es una película que hemos visto en múltiples ocasiones, no solamente en Venezuela, sino en múltiples contextos, tanto de América Latina como en otros contextos a nivel global, ¿no? Y por supuesto, conocemos el guión, sin embargo, creo que la gran diferencia es que en este instante, el imperialismo estadounidense y sus satélites y sus títeres regionales, llámese Chile, por ejemplo, de Boric, han llegado a un momento de crítico, porque en este momento la doctrina Monroe está amenazada por los vínculos que Venezuela y otras naciones han forjado con otros grupos, ¿no? No nada más en bloque, el bloque de los BRICS, sino también de manera independiente con otros países que resisten al imperialismo estadounidense. Entonces, si piensan que Venezuela está sola, están totalmente equivocados, no nada más a través presencia de observadores o amigos de Venezuela, sino también a través de estados nacionales, algunos de ellos potencia, que están dispuestos a arriesgarse y apoyar a Venezuela, porque la lucha a favor de Venezuela es la lucha a favor de estos pueblos, ¿no? Y es algo muy parecido a lo que dijo Chema. ¿A qué grado están dispuestos a llegar estos sujetos? Véase Palestina, cometiendo un genocidio frente a cámaras donde han sido asesinados más de 50.000 personas en 9 meses, aunque como tú lo mencionas, es un proceso muy longevo, pero aquí se puede ver el recrudecimiento y en la fase de decrepitud del sistema mundo capitalista y de su epicentro estadounidense, que no está dispuesto a arriesgar su periferia, porque a fin de cuentas América Latina lo consideran históricamente su periferia. Y sí, lamentablemente esta es una... un refrito que tenemos que volver a presenciar y volver justamente a defender un proceso democrático, porque a fin de cuentas, a pesar de todas las evidencias, van a tratar de contrarrestarle la victoria de Nicolás Maduro, y aquí comienza otra batalla justamente para la supervivencia del pueblo venezolano.
Bueno, y aquí estamos para la guerrilla cultural, juntos, por supuesto, Cristian Nader, Henry de Malcón y yo mismo, Chema Sánchez, estamos dispuestos a seguir siendo guerrilleros. Esa guerra cultural, esa guerra mediática, y si hace falta la otra,
por supuesto,
también estamos, ¿no? Para lo que haga falta. Nicolás Maduro, viva la revolución bolivariana, viva la revolución chavista, viva Nicolás Maduro.
¡Viva!
¡Viva!
Listo.
Ahora...
pues quedó excelente.
Pues ahora, para saber si ha sido bueno para la...
Well, we are here today joined together Sebastián Salgado, Cristian Nader, Tim Anderson and Marwa Osman. All of us are trying to talk a little bit about the situation, not only in Caracas, Venezuela, but in the rest of the world, in the anti-imperialism moment, so crucial, so important. This turning point, this real turning point for the world going to a multipolar world, a real fair play world with the game that is the Western rules based in wars are changing to a new Asiatic rules based in the sovereignty of all the countries. Well, here we are with Marwa. Marwa is living in the nuclear point of the world now, near Palestina, and with a moment very, very urgent with Lebanon, Beirut, and Hezbollah, and the resistance of the Palestinian people. And then we want to know some of this. We are in Venezuela. You can talk about Venezuela also, but also we are very, very interested in knowing how is it the moment for Palestinian people and for your...
Yes. Yep. Well, first of all, I'm very thankful that I am here in Venezuela to witness firsthand how democracy was basically presented to the world, because a lot of the mainstream media was talking about the elections in Venezuela, how President Maduro is going either to rig the elections or that he will not win, and the people of Venezuela proved them wrong, and I was here to witness that and speak with them and visit a lot of polling stations, so that was a very good experience for me. But at the same time, as we were visiting the polling stations, some new developments were taking place in both Lebanon and Gaza. In Gaza, for example, the Zionist entity committed a new massacre in a school in Deir el-Balah, killing children, beheading, literally beheading children, people who are holding their babies without heads because of the Zionist entity. Added to that, 2 days ago, there was a failure in the Iron Dome over the Mashd al-Shams town in the occupied Syrian Golan Heights, and that missile, it actually struck a football field where children were playing. And these children are Syrian Arab children under occupation. And they were from the age of 9 to 15, so we are talking about kids who were struck by a failed Iron Dome. 15 minutes after the incident, Hezbollah released a statement saying, we did not release a drone, we did not fire a missile, this was a failed Iron Dome, and this was not the first time that it happened.
And they transformed it in a false flag attack.
Yes.
Against,
I will tell you how that happened, but because we are following, it's been 10 months, first of all, Hezbollah so far has not targeted any civilians, despite the fact that he has every right to, because Zionists civilians. So we have every right to reciprocate and counter attacks. But that was not the case, because since the beginning of the war, especially the last 4 months, the Iron Dome has been failing desperately, especially in Majd al-Shams. And you can find videos online that would give evidence of what I'm talking of, the failed missiles that were being launched and were fired by mistake on Majd al-Shams. So that was just another failure in the Iron Dome. And the Israelis, at the beginning, they themselves, in breaking news, the Israeli army radio initiated a statement saying that it was a failed Iron Dome. But then an hour later, everyone was on board the same narrative that it was Hezbollah. He attacked children. He's killing. Why would they attack a town when they have been for the past 10 months targeting only military sites that would 100% hurt the Zionist entity? Why would they want to hurt their own people in Golan Heights? Despite the fact that Hezbollah issued the statement, Hezbollah was very fast in also issuing a warning, saying that in case this false flag attack is used by Zionist Israel to bomb Lebanon, because Israel is saying it's going to bomb Beirut and the suburbs of Beirut, Hezbollah said one strike, one drone, or one bullet falls on Lebanon and the capital Beirut, we will reciprocate. We will fire back on Tel Aviv the same way to the same places that they target. So a lot of people diplomatically have been working on it, especially France and the United States of America. And I was just reading now that there was a statement by the State Department when they were asked if they will issue a warning for the American citizens living in Lebanon to leave. They said, no, we're not going to issue that warning, because you had Saudi Arabia, Sweden, and a couple of other countries yesterday, at least 5 countries issued statements telling their residents to leave Lebanon. And for some period of time, there were a lot of flights canceled into Beirut International Airport in fear that Zionist Israel will bomb it. But this morning, things have lightened up a bit. Even some major news media outlets like the New York Times and the Washington Post doubled down on their agenda, which they portrayed yesterday, saying that Hezbollah struck Majd al-Shams. Today they're saying that there is a possibility that this was an Iron Dome. We knew from day one, like the first 15 minutes, because the resistance said so. And they, by the way, the resistance in 2006 did launch certain missiles, and they landed in Naharia on Palestinian Arabs. And the resistance back then apologized and sent a message to the families of these people and told them, please leave the areas of contact, because we don't know where the missile would fall. But we are at a time where Hezbollah knows exactly where every missile is falling, because it's a guided missile. So there's no error. There's no place or space for error in this case, especially because it was in the heart of the town. So it was obviously a failed Iron Dome missile. But the threats that are being initiated at the moment by Zionist Israel were repeatedly denounced by Hezbollah and by the Lebanese as well, by the Lebanese government, saying that any form of attack will be taken very, very seriously. Now, there are certain Arab treacherous media, like Al-Hadath TV, that issued reports saying that tonight is the night that Israel will strike Lebanon. We don't have evidence of that, but there's evidence that from Wednesday until Sunday, from Wednesday, August, July 31st, till Sunday, week of August, the Naharia train station will be shut down. So the question is why? And Naharia is very close to South Lebanon. So the question would be, why would they choose to shut down this train station from Wednesday to Sunday? It means that throughout that period, they might most probably might strike Lebanon. And for me, I believe it's going to be a very big mistake, not only because I'm Lebanese from South Lebanon, but because I fully believe the threats issued by the resistance in Lebanon that it will reciprocate any attack that it falls on.
Well, I think that this moment is a moment that where the media, the orchestrated media, that is with the aggression of USA, Netanyahu go and receive an applause, a big applause of the great parliament of the United States of America. And he comes back with the new baptism of the great leader that he is for them. And then all this orchestrated media is in reality for the cynic rules of the world. at the same time is an orchestrated media with these absurd ideas of this attack is in reality for the domestic consumer or the USA citizens. They only need to convince them, the domestic city, because the Europe is going to do what they want. And then, what do you think about this? Is maybe an occasion again for confront this?
Yes, I think in this situation, we shouldn't forget that the United States is having presidential elections. And if Donald Trump will win, maybe they will have to shut down the NATO war against the Russian Federation in Ukraine. So I think the military industry is very worried about that. So they always need at least one big war going around. And it seems that the Middle East, it will be the next point in which the United States will push somehow Israel to fight against all the Muslim and Arab countries in that area. But at the same time, we have seen how Yemen is fighting back, we have seen how Hezbollah is fighting back, and we would like to see what the Islamic Republic of Iran is going to do about this. So this situation between the Zionist regime and the Palestinians in Gaza, it seems that it's going to spread somehow in the region. So from my point of view, that even could have been the end of Israel in the way we have known that regime until now.
They are running away forward. Don't you think so? They are running away forward. In some way, they are trying to escape, but going in advance to spreading the war.
I think it's the final phase of the Anglo supremacy period in the last 500 years. Well, European or Eurodescent supremacy of the last 500 years. Concretamente, the Anglo-speaking empires, French, the British, the American. And at this point, they are able to really try to borrow the whole world to maintain the supremacy, their hegemonic power. And we have seen things that, well, we saw them before, but not at the same rate of time. I mean, in the last 9 months, we have seen in multiple parts of the world, and a level of violence without precedent, even for the United States, and even for global imperialism. The case of Ukraine, against trying to empantanar to the Russian Federation in a forever war. That's one scenario. We go to Palestine. I mean, the process against Palestine started a century ago, 76 years ago, but what began nearly 10 months ago, it's a phase of violence that we are seeing a genocide with cameras in live moment. It's terrible, and this is a response of the crisis that imperialism is, well, living. Not just in the Middle East, not just in the Mediterranean, in the Maghreb, but also in Latin America. In Venezuela, where we are right now, they're living a moment of prosperity. They're beginning their economy to restructure their economy. So, a partir de eso, we must consider that the America are losing the Monroe Doctrine. The Monroe Doctrine is more is threatened because we are making connections from Venezuela, from Latin America, from the poles of resistance to other parts of the world that are also resisting against American imperialism and their satellites and their puppets in the region. We have so many examples. In the case of Chile, it's terrible, it's brutal, but it's, and also the case, for example, countries like Colombia, they have to make a choice. you're with the resistance or you're against them. Because the case of Petro is very similar. Petro has been living a period of instability because of the propaganda against him, but now he's taking the same propaganda against the Venezuelan government. That's very strange. So I think this moment is decisivo para todo, for all mankind, pero concretamente for the global south. I think it's the more important thing. And we're making the connections. I think it's a global resistance against imperialism.
Dean Anderson is an intellectual
that knows very, very well the area of the zone. And he's always in this cultural work for the anti-imperialism. And also, not only the war, the axis of the resistance countries. And do you think the moment of truth is coming for the Siamese and this accelerated, this speed up of Lebanon, of Zionists now with Netanyahu, is possible the dead end for him?
In English?
Yes, in English.
Yes, I think the contradictions of the regime are ripening, as they say. That the internal weakness, the collapse of international support, the collapse of the Israeli military and its reliance on international support, the big campaigns which are weakening the political will to keep arming that regime, those things are all increasing, and at the same time there's a unique regional cooperation going on. We haven't seen the cooperation between the Yemeni resistance and the Iraqi resistance before. We haven't seen Iran directly striking the Israeli regime. We are only seeing the beginnings of the Lebanese resistance attacking the Israeli military. So, and of course, no one expected the degree of success that the guerrilla fighters in Gaza would have in the south of the Israeli regime. So all of these factors are coming together, and of course, this means many things are unknown, but nevertheless, the ripening of those contradictions is certainly the case. And really, the international support has abandoned in many respects the Israeli regime, looking for ways out, at least, let's say. The US has maintained its support for its colony so far, despite the fact that there's a collapse in the internal support amongst the youth there. But the Europeans are all looking for their way out in different ways. You've seen that yourself, of course, that they're trying to paper over it and pretend that they are at arm's length from this genocidal regime. So all those contradictions are ripening in a way we don't see exactly what will happen. I myself suspect that the internal problems, the internal lack of cohesion is a major factor which may lead to a collapse of the Israeli regime, but then we'll be looking at a reconstruction of an Israeli regime by its key sponsors, the British and the US. And that may be a set of compromises which will create a lot of surprise and attract a lot of attention, but require a lot of focus by the resistance to make sure that there aren't very serious compromises embedded in Israel Mark II, if there is an Israel Mark II.
Well, finally, you can ask whatever you want to her, but my last question, after you can ask her something, but my last question is, do you know, Marwa, that Iran change of presidency was used by some people in the Western media to say, well, now it's not the same, we can go and westernize this presidency in some way. Yes, you and me laugh at all that.
The issue is, look, Chema, the first letter that was sent by the President Bezeshkian, before he even took office, was sent to Hezbollah leader Sayyid Hassan Nasrallah. What are they talking about? The elections that happen in Iran, they happen under the auspices of the leader of the Islamic Revolution. Whoever is to be elected is under the auspices of the principles of the Islamic Revolution. It's not someone being installed by the yes or us. The people will not vote for them because the revolution is the people. But saying that if it's an Islahi or it's a reformist or if it's a conservative, that's a preference for the people. And by the way, elected, Pezeshkian has a history in politics. He's not only a heart surgeon, but he has a history in politics because he was a member of parliament and people loved him. And people saw how he served the public equally, not necessarily a reformist or a conservative. But at the same time, when people say, oh, the conservatives lost, but if they look in details about the election process in Iran, they could see that the mishap that happened was that Qalibaf did not leave the elections or leave the candidacy for Dr. Jalili. If that had happened, the voices, the voting process, the voters would not have been split between Jalili and Qalibaf. And the difference, the percentile difference is very, very close, which means that it is a choice by the people, and there was some sort of mishaps in the first round of elections. But that's okay, because everything is under the auspices of the leader. And yesterday, just last night, Sayyid Ali Khamenei, the leader of the revolution, was at the inauguration of President Pezeshkian and gave a speech during that inauguration. And it was compatible between both men's speeches. So what are they talking about? People who talk like that really have no idea how the system inside of Iran works and how the institutions are really independent institutions. How there's elections at all levels, and how things, when they are played on an internal level, they don't necessarily mean that it will be the same at an external level. At the level of the foreign ministry, the first thing that was issued by the foreign ministry that Gaza should have a ceasefire and Palestine should be liberated. That's coming from the new president. So what's the change about the foreign policy that everyone's talking about? Nothing. Change inside of Iran, that's their right to do the changes that they see fit because they were elected by the people.
Very, there is not a weakening position, there is a strong position.
Actually, it's a strong position telling how much of that this system, how much of a winning system it is, how much of a successful system it is. Because if that was not the case, people would have not voted, and maybe the conservatives would have won. And we would have heard another tune saying that the elections were rigged, but now they're saying, oh, a new power, things will change. Things will change on the inside, as they should, because Iran is under sanctions from the West, and the new president promised leniency towards talking to the West to try to use diplomacy. But, I mean, the former president Rouhani tried that, and it was a total failure. And Sayyid Ali Khamenei already told them that the JCPOA will not work because the Americans will not keep their promise. That's exactly what happened when Trump became president. And now, he was asked, the new president was asked about the JCPOA, and he said that we've tried that, we might try something else now, because that failed. We're not going to go back to a failed agreement. So no one knows how things will go from here, but for sure, when it comes to the resistance, this is part of the Iranian foreign policy. It's not going to change, especially because of elections. Will the U.S. change if Trump comes instead of Biden? They will keep supporting Israel. So why is it so hard for them to understand that Iran will keep supporting the resistance even if a president is changing?
No, sure. I think Iran gonna make whatever strong position that it must do, but at the same time, Iran never goes to fall without the help of Russia, of China. They three, both three, are joined together in a final destiny, and this is a strong position for me. That is make they try to go and spread the word for.
Different perspective of the use of hijab instead of that. Do you think it would be any difference?
Well, I don't know if you saw the first lady. She's a hijabi wearing a abaya, not a normal hijab, a full abaya. That's the first lady, that's the wife of the president. So whatever he thinks about hijab, that's for him and that's for the Iranian people to vote for. But if you haven't been to Iran lately, I advise you to go, because I was there 2 months ago, and I was there even 2 years ago. 2 years ago, when I was walking down the streets of Iran, of Tehran specifically, vote and choose to keep hijab compulsory, or at least as it is now, meaning that in areas that where religious sites are, you have to wear a hijab. That's the same thing in Saudi Arabia. That's the same thing if you go to the Kaaba, if you go to the pilgrimage, you have to be wearing on your head. If you go to a church in Syria, you have to put something on your head. So that's respect for the religious sites. If they vote to keep that respect for religious sites, that's their issue. If they vote to completely take it off, that's their issue. And if they vote to keep it as is, that's an internal Iranian issue that I really have no say and really don't care about. What I care about is if I go to another country and they oblige me to take it off. That's what I care about. For me as a Muslim woman, I don't want anyone to tell any woman what to wear or not to wear. Yes, it happened to me in Uganda. They wanted to they wanted me to take off my hijab so they could take a photo for the visa. And if I go to France, for example, I've been to Italy, I swam with my burkini in the Mediterranean. I went to Greece, I swam in my burkini in the Mediterranean. If I go to France, I'm not allowed to swim because I'm covering my head. I don't know what they do in the winter. Do they go down scuba diving in the winter, or they also don't cover anything while scuba diving? It's ridiculous. That's what I am concerned about. I'm not concerned if Iran or Saudi Arabia or other Arab and Muslim countries change their laws or not. What I want is equality for chances, for opportunities in medicine, in education, in workplace. That's what I want. Why would I care what anyone wears or doesn't wear on their head or on their body? I don't care.
Well, I think I would find out for this talking would be that you both ask each other one question.
Sure. I'd love to ask that. Tim, because you've been in Venezuela before, did you see something different than the trip before at this time? Do you think that after this election we might see another wave of violence on the streets of Venezuela? Not particularly Caracas, maybe other areas.
There's always the possibility of violence here because as President Nicolas was saying today, the opposition has become extremely embedded in fascism and committed to coups and attempts at assassination and so on. What I noticed the difference really was, not so much this year, but 2 years ago from 10 years ago, is that the embeddedness of the Bolivarian Revolution, including the principles of the Constitution, are in the institutions now. They're in the police, they're in the army. When there was big rallies 2 years ago, there were a lot of civilians in arms. There's a very big militia here, millions of people under arms. So they will come to the big rallies now in uniform, you know. So that's different in a way. It's because, of course, Venezuela has faced such a lot of coup attempts and invasions, you know, from Bush through to Trump, basically. And as the president was saying, several assassination attempts earlier this year. That really, they've had to solidify some of the institutions in face of this constant pressure. And I think they have to, every independent state in the world has to become what the US sees as a dictatorship, because if not, they'll be destroyed. If they are weak liberal democracies, they will be simply overturned, basically. They have to really have a strong state to resist this pressure, to crush and destroy and incorporate all of the independent states in the world. And that's why they call them dictatorships, because they don't give in. They maintain their position.
Yeah. Well, your question for her, your last.
My question for Marwa is, I hope you can get back home and look after your girls, you know, because the country's facing terrible aggression at the moment, and I know some people want the war to widen, but no one really is advantaged by a war widening. It's terrible, you know. If there's going to be a war, it should be short and sharp, and, you know, all of those Zionist weapons, batteries and planes should be knocked out in one hit if there's to be an effective war. No one wants to see a protracted war. It's going to hurt all of our friends and relatives.
Well, I completely see what you're saying, and I second your idea that no one really wants war, but with a Zionist entity that has been committing genocide over the past 10 months, it's been now clear and exposed to the whole world that they only understand power. They understand nothing but power, which is why like up until now they haven't attacked Beirut, for example. The only thing is deterrence, power. It's stopping them from attacking us, killing more Lebanese civilians. And I wish that we could say the same about Gaza, but the resistance is still viable and it's still strong in Gaza, and we support it at every angle, and we support it before Al-Aqsa flood, during and after Al-Aqsa flood. And we'll continue to support it even after, the day after the war on Gaza. But Lebanon in specific is a very exclusive case, you know, it's a very important case of how the people and the resistance merge together to face an occupation, kick it out, liberate the land, and then basically make up a new form of resistance that is embedded in the communities, not only as military resistance, but also as social and political resistance, which allowed Hezbollah to become such a powerful force of resistance in the region and become a leading force in the axis of resistance against the Zionist Israelis alongside Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Yemen. And the possibility of an increasing spectrum of more factions joining in is being seen. We're seeing it in the horizon at the moment. We've seen in Egypt the newcomers who named themselves the Muhammad Salah Resistance Brigades. We've seen in Libya some forces who said we want a part of the resistance. And I think that this is a movement that will sweep across the Arab world and hopefully the Islamic world. This is our time, Tim. It's our time to regain power back to where it belongs, to the natives. Exactly. And whether or not I make it back home, whether swimming or actually taking a different route, a different flight, I'm going to make it back home. And whether or not my people are safe, I have full faith that we will win this. No matter the price, we are the natives. We will win this.
And you're passing from a resistant context in Latin America to another resistant context in the Arab-speaking world. So
yeah.
I think it's very emblematic. Thank you very much for
my pleasure. And viva Maduro, viva Venezuela, viva Cuba, viva the entire Latin Americas against imperialism. May the people be able to determine their own rights to self-determination, to sovereignty, to ruling, to their own resources, away from the hands of imperialism, no matter what that imperialism is. And basically, viva the people. The people are the essence of every revolution, and that's where our faith resides.
Muchas gracias.
Well, Palestina will be free from the river to the sea. We will win, and the Zionist is about to disappear forever.
And what's the word? Sanantasir. Sanantasir. We will be victorious.
Y Venezuela también.
Bueno, pero estamos en tierra liberada. We are in free land now. And then from this free land, Palestine will be free from the river to the sea.
Thank you.
Gracias.